Going into their last group match, New Zealand knew a win or a draw would put them through to the semi-finals because Australia and Argentina still had to play each other. Only a comfortable win would give Germany a chance of reaching the last four, and they took an early blow when captain Fanny Rinner suffered a hand injury. Crystal Forgerson's powerful shot hit Rinner painfully on the knuckles. But it didn't keep her off the field for long. She was back less than 10 minutes later when New Zealand created this chance. Germany goalkeeper Yvonne Frank did well to make the save from Charlotte Harrison. Just before half-time, Germany thought they'd scored when Micah Stöckl put the ball into the net. But the video umpire ruled Stöckl didn't touch the ball as it went through the scoring circle. In the second half, New Zealand goalkeeper Bianca Russell kept Germany at bay. This save to deny Lisa Hahn meant New Zealand clinched a place in the semi-finals and Germany could no longer qualify. The result, New Zealand 0, Germany 0.
The final round of matches in Group B of the men's competition. Australia and Russia were both already through to the quarterfinals and couldn't alter their finishing positions in the group, but they still served up a mini classic. Matt Dellavedova's pass to Aaron Baines. There was never much between the teams. Here, Sasha Kaoun throws the Australian defence off balance. And Australia's Brad Newley wrong-foots Alexei Shved. Into the final quarter, and watch how Andrei Kirilenko scores despite having one arm locked up by a defender. It came down to the final play. Russia led by one with 4.1 seconds remaining. Patrick Mills, the hero, as Australia win by two and take huge confidence into the quarterfinals. They'll need it. Their likely next opponents are the United States. Despite the defeat, Russia are group winners.
It was crunch time at the Copper Box, where Hungary and Serbia met to fight for one of the two remaining quarter-final places in the men's handball. Hungary needed to beat Serbia to progress to the last eight from Group B. For Serbia, a draw would be enough thanks to their superior goal difference. And with so much at stake, both teams started nervously. But they soon settled down and the goals started to flow at both ends. At times it was breathless. The timeouts were well deserved. Serbia went into the break with a slender lead, but in the second half, Hungary came storming back to set up a thrilling finale. In the end, Hungary's defence held firm to claim a remarkable victory, and with it, the last remaining quarter-final place from Group B. Serbia fall agonisingly short. Their Olympic Games is over. Full time at the Copper Box, Hungary 26, Serbia 23.
The final round of group games and a must-win match for Australia. Only a victory over fancied Poland would keep their hopes of reaching the quarterfinals alive. Success for the Poles would give them a chance of topping the group and avoiding the tournament's other medal hopefuls in the last eight. But despite a world ranking 19 places above their opponents, they had no answer to Australia's best performance at London 2012. They went all out in defence and outpowered Poland at the net to take a 1-0 lead in the best of five-set match. It was only when they were 2-0 down that Poland finally found some form and had their opponents on the run. They'd take the set 25-18. Set four was superb. Poland never quite able to pull away and level the match. It hinged on a fantastic defensive play from Australia's Thomas Edgar. It edged his side ahead late in the set, and they wouldn't let the lead slip. Their quarter-final plays now rest on other results, as do Poland's hopes of topping the group.
Kazakhstan and Croatia were drawn to meet in their final preliminary match in men's water polo Group A. There was nothing more than pride at stake for Kazakhstan, who had no chance of going through to the quarterfinals. They were beaten again here. It was a comfortable victory for Croatia, who were top of the group after four wins from four and already through to the quarters. Croatia 4-0 up after the first period. The defence went to sleep momentarily to allow Kazakhstan their solitary goal of the first half. It was little more than a training session for Croatia. They were too strong for their opponents and could easily have had more than 12 goals. Their next match would mean much more, the quarterfinals.
The Olympic rowing lake at Eton Dorney was back in action as the London 2012 sprint canoe events got underway. A series of heats and semi-finals took place in four of the 12 events. In the K2 kayak event over 1,000 metres, the German pair of Martin Holstein and Andreas Ehler won straight through to the final from their heat. They won gold in Beijing 4 years ago. In the K1 kayak event over 1,000 metres, Canada's Adam van Cuverden qualified comfortably for the final, along with the 2004 Olympic champion Erik Verish Larsen. The defending Olympic champion Tim Brabants of Great Britain scraped through in fourth place. In the C1 event over 1,000 metres, Germany's Sebastian Brendel won a well-contested semi-final ahead of the defending Olympic champion Attila Vajda of Hungary. The top four paddlers qualify for the A final, which is the gold medal race. And in the women's kayak fours over 500 metres, teams from Hungary, Germany and Portugal qualified directly into the final from their heats. And they'll be joined there by teams from Poland, Belarus, Russia, Great Britain and France, who finished in the top five in the event's only semi-final.
The United States and South Africa were the bottom two teams in Pool B, and the United States went into the match with a 10-goal advantage in terms of goal difference. But incredibly, South Africa picked up their first win of the competition and overturned that goal difference. South Africa scored first in the 14th minute. And once the floodgates opened, South Africa couldn't stop scoring. Piti Kutsia made it 4-0 before half-time, adding to goals from Leselan George and Jennifer Wilson. South Africa had to win by five clear goals to climb above the United States in the table, and Bright's second of the match put them on course to do just that. Soon after that, the United States were reduced to 10 players while Shannon Taylor served a five-minute suspension. South Africa took advantage to make it 6-0, but the United States were back to full strength when Kutsia made it 7. So South Africa climbed off the bottom of the Pool B table and they'll play for ninth place in the classification matches. The results, the United States 0, South Africa 7.
Greece and Australia were drawn to meet in their last preliminary match in men's water polo Group A. Plenty to play for, a place in the quarterfinals. Nothing less than a win would do for Australia. A draw would be enough for Greece. It was Australia who went through. Nip and tuck through the first quarter, Rhys Howden with a fast finish, which put Australia 3-2 up after the first quarter. Goals can come through small margins. This shot from Jamie Beedsworth just crept into the goal mouth, much to the frustration of the Greek coach, Dragan Andric. Plenty of work for Greece to do, 8-5 down going into the second half. But the momentum stayed with Australia, strong in defence as well as attack. Greece were five goals down going into the final quarter. They stepped up the tempo, but it just wasn't their day. An impressive performance from Australia to put them through to the quarterfinals. Greece were out of medal contention.
Nerves were jangling at the Copper Box where Argentina and Tunisia battled it out for the one remaining quarterfinal place from Group A. Argentina, the Pan American champions, needed a win to progress. For Tunisia, a draw would suffice thanks to their superior goal difference. And despite the high stakes, the African champions made a dream start, racing into a 4-0 lead. Gradually, though, Argentina worked their way back into the game. And at half-time, it was all square at 12 points apiece. Just one quarter-final place available. Which team would take it? The second half was tense. Tempers started to flare, and the Tunisian winger Touati was sent off for this illegal tackle. But once again, the North Africans got themselves in front. And this time, they stayed there to complete the narrowest of victories. Tunisia qualify for their first ever Olympic quarter-final. For Argentina, London 2012 is over. Full-time at the Copper Box, Argentina 23, Tunisia 25.
Tunisia against Lithuania in Group A of the men's basketball competition. Victory for Lithuania would take them into the quarterfinals for the sixth consecutive Olympic Games. Tunisia were hoping for their first win in Olympic basketball and knew a big victory could propel them to the knockout stage. And it was the African champions in white who made the stronger start. Salah Mejri was looking particularly motivated by the task in hand. Tunisia would lead by 6 points at half-time. Radouan Slimane with this three-pointer. But as the third quarter came to an end, Lithuania upped their game. Darius Songaila with two of his 13 points. And the Tunisian coach was urging calm. But Lithuania forged in front, winning the final quarter by 26 points to 9. Ronaldas Saibutis clearly enjoyed making back-to-back three-pointers. And Lithuania ran out winners by 13 points to set up an intriguing quarter-final against Russia. Tunisia leave with 5 defeats, but some new friends and a sense they deserve better results.
Battle at XL's North Arena 1 for the conclusion of the women's team table tennis semifinals. China was in action against the Republic of Korea. For the Chinese, it was the opportunity to advance and play for another gold. Korea, on the other hand, looked for a huge upset versus the favorites. The singles match featured recent gold medal winner Lee Xiaosha and Korea's Siuk Ha Jung. Xiaosha was simply dominant, especially during the most crucial plays. China had a 1-0 lead after the first match. Singles match number 2 pitted China's Ding Ning against Kim Kyung-ga. The women put on a show for the crowd with drop shots, backhand slices, and powerful forehands in many of their rallies. It was Ning, though, who came out on the winning end of many of the shots. She won in straight games to give China a 2-0 lead in team play. Doubles action brought China's Guo Yuwei into the fray. She was paired with Xiaosha, while Korea went with Dang Yeseo and Ha Jung. China completed the 3-match sweep and will now face Japan for the gold.
After a come-from-behind victory over the United States in their last match, a straight sets win over Serbia secured Russia's place in the quarterfinals, damaging their opponent's last 8 chances in the process. 2 sets down and 2 points from defeat against the USA, Russia, wearing blue, rallied for a crucial win and continued in that same form against the Serbs. They rolled through the first set, taking it in just 21 minutes, and remained just as dominant in the next 2. Inconsistent early in the tournament, Russia are getting better as it goes on. They blocked powerfully to take the second set and won the third 25-17 to seal a straight set success and a place in the last 8. Despite their demolition, Serbia could still progress as well. That will depend on the other final round results in preliminary Group B.
Day 9 at the Weymouth and Portland National Sailing Centre, and time for what promised to be a thrilling finale to the women's laser radial class. Heading into the decisive medal race, where all points count double, just a single point separated four gold medal hopefuls. That's China's Lilia Xu, the bronze medalist from Beijing, reigning world champion Marit Boumeester of the Netherlands, the ever-dangerous Evie Van Acker of Belgium, and 22-year-old Irish student Annalise Murphy. A fast start was essential for all four sailors amid yet more blustery conditions on Great Britain's south coast. And it was Xu who made the first decisive move in a successful bid to steal a march on her rivals. But Boumeester, Murphy and Van Acker were all close behind. And that remained the case as an incredibly tight and tense battle neared its conclusion. But Xu, the 24-year-old from Shanghai, couldn't be caught, and in a masterful display of sailing, crossed the finish line 8 seconds ahead of her closest rival to secure her first Olympic gold medal. Boumeester had to settle for second place on the podium, with Van Acker just 4 seconds further back in the bronze medal position. So while the Chinese supporters and Xu herself began celebrating her triumph in jubilant fashion, Murphy narrowly missed out on the top three in heartbreaking fashion, despite winning the first four races of the series. The gold medal then went to China's Lijia Xu, 4 years on from claiming bronze in Beijing. Marit Boumeester of the Netherlands took the silver medal, and bronze went to Belgium's Evie Van Acker.
I feel very privileged to be part of the Games, so I give everything with all of my heart, and I wanted to give a special thank to John and Matt and Jenny, my Pilates teacher, and all the English support team. Yeah.
What does it mean to you to have won the gold medal?
I just feel very proud of my nation. Because sailing in China is not that popular, so maybe after the gold medal, I can introduce this sport to more people in China. Yeah, let them feel the joy of sailing on the wild sea.
In the final of the men's 50-meter rifle three positions, Niccolò Campriani started with an enormous lead. His score of 1,180 points in qualifying was an Olympic record. It gave him an 8-point advantage over Matt Emmons. It would take a huge mistake for Campriani to miss out on the gold medal. But Emmons, on the left, knew just how important every shot could be in the final. He made big mistakes with his last shot in the final of this event in both Athens and Beijing when the gold medal was in reach. Campriani remained consistent during the final, but the battle for the silver and bronze was close. With two shots left, Campriani was still out in front, but there was less than a point between Emmons in second place and Kim Jong-hyun in third. Campriani was holding his nerve, and Kim was scoring well too. But Emmons had the best ninth shot of the top three. That score meant he would only need 9.3 or better with his final shot to take the silver medal. Campriani only needed a modest final shot to become Olympic champion. The real pressure over the last shot would be on Emmons' shoulders. In Beijing, he scored a 4.4 with his last shot and slipped from first to fourth place. In Athens, he fired his final shot at the wrong target. And once again here, his final shot cost him. That score of 7.6 meant Emmons dropped to third place. Kim's final shot was good enough to take him past Emmons into second. And Campriani only needed to score 5.3 or better to finish first. A moment of glory for Campriani, and Emmons was the first to congratulate him. The bronze medal for Emmons, who'd been treated for thyroid cancer since Beijing. Silver for Kim, who scored 101.5 in the final, more than anyone else. And gold for Campriani, who won a silver medal in the 10-metre air rifle competition earlier in the Games.
I'm glad it's finished. I'm really glad it's finished. And then I will enjoy it back home with my parents, but right now I'm just... It was a really long week for me, and 10 days. It was really hard to keep the focus at the village, and there was always a fight. I couldn't enjoy the silver that I won 10 days ago. It was really, really hard. There were a lot of expectations, so I'm glad it's finished.
North Greenwich Arena hosted the Artistic Gymnastics Men's Rings Final. The top 8 gymnasts went through to this final after the qualifying round. Chen Yibing won gold in this event at Beijing 2008. Matteo Morandi was competing at his third Olympic Games. They were the main chances. Arthur Navarette-Zanetti was an Olympic debutante. A great story here was Iordan Iovchev from Bulgaria. He was competing at his third Olympic Games at 39 years of age. He finished 7th, a great effort just to be there. At 30 years old, Matteo Morandi was still a strong competitor. His routine earned him the bronze medal. The opening routine came from Chen Yibing. He set a great benchmark and ultimately won silver. The shock came with the very last routine. Arthur Navarette-Zanetti came to the stage and was the example of balance and strength, and he took the gold medal. So the 22-year-old Navarette-Zanetti became the first gymnast from Brazil to win a medal of any colour in the rings. Chen Yibing was an excellent example of the defeated, especially after being overtaken in the final routine. The medal ceremony crowned a new Olympic champion. Gold to Arthur Navarette-Zanetti, silver to Chen Yibing, and bronze to Matteo Morandi.
I feel very, very, very good because it's first medal for my country in artistic gymnastics, and I'm feel so glad. I feel so happy. For me, it's my for my life because it's my job and a long time for job, and I'm satisfied for this medal.
Another large crowd was on hand at the Weymouth and Portland National Sailing Centre for the medal race in the men's laser class. Australia's Tom Slingsby held an 8-point lead in the overall standings ahead of Cypriot Pavlos Kontidis, who also enjoyed a sizeable and animated following. The battle for the bronze medal looked like a straight fight between Sweden's Rasmus Migrin and Tonči Stepanović of Croatia. Surprisingly, none of the medal contenders got off to a particularly good start, meaning an unfamiliar look at the front of the field as the race began to take shape. Kontidis knew he had to finish at least 4 places ahead of Slingsby to stand any chance of winning gold, but the 5-time world champion was remaining ice cool under the pressure and pulled ahead of his main adversary just before the first mark. As the fight at the front continued to rage on regardless, Slingsby knew that top spot on the podium was now very much within his grasp. Meanwhile, Migrin was starting to make his way through the field, ultimately securing the bronze medal with a 6th place finish. In the end, medal race honours went to Germany's Simon Grotelüschen, who crossed the line just 2 seconds ahead of Alejandro Funklia Costa of Uruguay, with the 2008 Olympic champion Paul Goodison of Great Britain finishing a disappointing Games in 3rd. But in terms of the overall standings, there was no stopping Tom Slingsby, whose 9th place finish was enough to see the 27-year-old crowned Olympic champion, with Kontidis crossing the line in 10th to guarantee the silver medal ahead of Migrin. No doubt it was Australia's day, as Slingsby proudly brought home the gold ahead of an equally proud Cypriot, Pavlos Kontidis. So the bronze medal was awarded to Rasmus Migrin of Sweden. Pavlos Kontidis' silver was Cyprus's first medal in Olympic history. and top spot on the podium was reserved for Tom Slingsby of Australia.
Words can't really describe it. I think I'm the happiest man on earth at the right now, and I've worked so hard for so long, and to win it like that and my friends and family watching, it's an amazing feeling.
What was the key moment for you in this regatta?
It was definitely, I think, race eight. After race seven, I had a 15th, and I'd had some bad results before that, and I just felt like the regatta was slipping away, my lead was gone, and I just thought, and I remember I was really nervous before the next race, and I came out and won that race, and then I won the next couple, and my confidence was high then. I knew I was going to be pretty hard to beat.
What does this gold mean to you?
It's a thing I've worked for 12 years now. 2004, I was about top 10 in the world, but I didn't get a chance to go to the Olympics. 2008, I was there, I was a favourite, and I didn't do well. I stuffed up, and then, finally, I get the chance to wear the gold medal.
In their final group match, China knew they had to beat Japan to stand any chance of reaching the semi-finals. Japan hadn't won any of their previous four matches, but they made a positive start to the game. Kaori Fujio narrowly missed this shot early on. At the other end, Fu Baorong had this shot saved by Japan goalkeeper Sakio Asano. In the second half, Japan took a surprise lead from this penalty corner. Rika Komazawa scored the goal. It was the first time in the entire competition Japan had been in front at any point in any match. China needed to win to have any chance of playing in the semi-finals, so they pushed for a goal, but this was the closest they came towards the end of the game. Zhao Liwa's shot saved once again by Asano. China's chances of qualifying were over. The result, Japan 1, China 0, and that confirmed the Netherlands and Great Britain would qualify from Pool A.
Romania and Serbia faced each other in men's water polo, their final preliminary match in Group B. Serbia came into this already through to the quarterfinals. Romania had nothing to play for, no chance of progressing. Filip Filipovic opened up the scoring for Serbia inside the first 15 seconds. With goals like this, you can see why Serbia were top of the group. They were too strong for Romania, 6-1 at half-time. The second half was little more than target practice for Serbia, a further six goals. But they would be sure to face tougher opposition in their quarter-final against Australia.
North Greenwich Arena hosted the Women's Artistic Gymnastics Uneven Bars Final. The top eight gymnasts went through to this final after the qualifying round. The start list included Herka Sin, who won gold in this event at Beijing 2008. Alia Mustafina was competing at her first Olympic Games. Local hope Beth Tweddle finished fourth 4 years ago. And with plenty of local support, Tweddle didn't disappoint with a bronze medal performance. Herka Sin is just 20 years old, and she collected her second medal in this event, this time a silver one. Alia Mustafina's consistency deserved some recognition, and she got that with a gold medal routine. And that was the finishing order. Beth Tweddle finally got an individual medal at her third Olympic Games. Alia Mustafina could not have wanted a better result. To the medal ceremony, and gold to Alia Mustafina, silver to Herka Sin, and bronze to Beth Tweddle.
What does it mean to you to win gold?
That's all the hard work I've done to get it.
How did you feel during your routine?
I was just thinking to make everything as good as I can.
Group B of the men's 105-kilogram class in weightlifting. Generally, the competitors here not in contention for the medals, barring a lift that goes well beyond expectations. One athlete was extremely impressive in the snatch. Ecuador's Jorge David Arroyo Valdez wowed the crowd with this lift of 185 kilograms. In the clean and jerk, Arturs Plesniaks was the standout. The winner of the 2010 Junior World Championships was successful at 215 kilograms. He wanted to make 225 kilograms, which would have given him a combined total of 400 kilos. Medalists in this event are all likely to notch total numbers of over 400. But he couldn't quite put himself in contention. Atop the standings at the end of the Group B division, Arturs Plesniaks of Latvia and Arroyo Valdez of Ecuador.
On the final day of group action at the men's handball, Denmark and South Korea headed to the copper box with different goals. Denmark, the European champions, had already qualified for the knockout stage. Victory here could earn them second place in Group B and a more favourable draw. Korea had lost all four group matches. Their coach was hoping to taste victory for the first time. And surprisingly, it was the Koreans who took an early lead. They continued to belie their lowly position by keeping pace with the European champions. And remarkably, Korea had a one-point lead at half-time, prompting the Denmark coach to take stock. Whatever he said, it paid off. Inside the last 10 minutes, the Danes finally got their noses in front. And from there, they held on for a hard-fought victory. Denmark move up into second place in Group B. Korea, despite their best efforts, leave London with nothing. Full time at the Copper Box, Denmark 26, South Korea 24.
Basketball Arena Group A final match of the preliminary round between France and Nigeria. France did what it had to do in the end and won. France controlled the pace of play in the first quarter. Boris Diaz scored from close to the basket. France led 23-10 after one quarter. But Nigeria kept it close thanks to the play of Chamberlain Oguchi. He scored 13 points in the first half alone. France transitioned from defense to attack quickly. Tony Parker found Mikhail Jalabal here, and France led by 11 at halftime. But Nigeria started to make shots in the third quarter. Chamberlain Oguchi scored on this shot from distance, good for 3 points, and the match was tied. But late in the fourth quarter, France began to outwork Nigeria under the basket. Off a missed shot, Kevin Serafin scored. Then France picked up the defensive pressure, and that led to this Nicolas Beita basket, and the victory was secure. France won its final preliminary match. They moved on to the quarterfinals.
What a game for another sellout Earls Court crowd. Italy and Bulgaria battling for top spot in Group A. The victors would win the group, meaning a quarter-final against the weakest qualifier from Group B. While Italy are World Cup champions and placed higher in the world rankings, Bulgaria have been a surprise team in London and upset the odds again. They started by taking a tight first set by 32 points to 30. Losing it was a hammer blow to Italy, who've not been at their best at the 2012 games and who wanted to avoid a quarter-final against another top team. But once they'd lost the second set as well, that's exactly what they were facing. Bulgaria were in no mood to let such a commanding lead slip and never let Italy out of their sight in a hard-fought third. At no point did Italy lead by more than one, and worn down by their opponents, would finally crack and lose it 25-19. Bulgaria topped the group, Italy anxiously awaiting the quarter-final draw.
The men's artistic gymnastics program continued at North Greenwich Arena with the vault final. The top eight gymnasts after the qualifying round competed here. Young Huck Sion had high hopes at his first Olympic Games. Dennis Obliazin was also making his Olympic debut, but had been busy across all the apparatus throughout the program. Igor Radivilov was an outside chance of collecting a medal. Despite his inexperience at big events, Radivilov withstood the pressure to claim bronze. Dennis Obliazin showed he was a medal contender in both of his two attempts. This earned him silver. 19 years old is young for a top vault performer. Young Huck Sion's ability as a gymnast belied his age. Gold went the way of the South Korean. The result displayed a bright future for the competition on the apparatus, with all the three medalists either 19 or 20 years of age. The medal ceremony confirmed gold to Young Huck Sion, silver to Dennis Obliazin, and bronze to Igor Radivilov.
We haven't had any gold medalist in the gymnastics yet, so I'm very proud of it. And the training didn't go very well, so I was very nervous, but the game planned out very well, so I'm very proud of it.
The second day ever in the history of the Olympic women's boxing. Stepping on the canvas were the fly under 51 kilograms contenders, Ren Kankan from China in red versus Elena Savulieva from Russia in blue. Ren is the world champion and number one seed, and Savulieva just couldn't match her opponent. It's the Chinese boxer who will be in the semifinals. Then came the women's light under 60 kilograms division. This is Katie Taylor from Ireland and Natasha Jonas from Great Britain. The atmosphere in the Excel Arena was extraordinary. Katie Taylor in red is number one seed, Natasha Jonas is the local hero. These two met last year in Bulgaria and Jonas won. This time Taylor took the lead from round one, Jonas gave all she had, but Katie Taylor was superior. A great finale to this bout, a hug and a celebration for the Irish. The session ended with the women's middle under 75 kilograms division. Savannah Marshall from Great Britain fought Marina Volnova from Kazakhstan. Marshall is number one seed. She is also the reigning world champion. Volnova in blue was in a second bout in London 2012. Both fighters were level after the first two rounds. Volnova eventually managed to take the lead. Marshall left the competition and is Volnova who the crowd will get to see again in the semifinals.
The final of the team jumping event at the Greenwich Park Arena. Only eight teams had qualified, with Saudi Arabia the surprise leaders after the opening day. Windy conditions caused a dramatic moment for José Roberto Reynoso Fernandez of Brazil. But the leading contenders weren't affected. Here's Scott Brash of Great Britain with a clear round that took the home team into the top two. Abdullah Sharbatli was the last rider for the overnight leaders, Saudi Arabia. His teammates' scores meant the best they could do was third place. But his round sealed only the third medal in Saudi Olympic history. Due cause for celebration. In the battle for gold and silver, Gerco Schroeder's round for the Netherlands would be crucial. A clear round and they'd win gold. Any more than four faults and the British would win. It meant the Netherlands and Great Britain were level, and there'd be a jump-off to decide the Olympic champions. The first two British riders put pressure on the Dutch by riding clear rounds. Mark Hoetzager needed to match them. His one mistake meant the last British rider, Peter Charles, could seal the gold medal with a clear round. It's the first gold medal in team jumping for Great Britain since 1952.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic medalists.
What did it feel like to go out there knowing that a clear round would win the gold for Great Britain?
Felt fine. Just going, we're all professionals. We can put that at the back of our mind. Focus on the arena. I said to the lads there, they said, if you have a fence down, don't come out this end. So simple, jump the jumps, and thank God I did.
Did you feel the tension out there though?
Yeah, a little bit. I'd be lying if I didn't, but I was very keen to get the job done and not let the lads down, you know. These lads carried it well. Nick, fantastic. Ben, fantastic. Scott, and they got me into that position where I could actually do something. So as a team, it was fantastic in the end.
Hungary and the USA faced each other in men's water polo, their final preliminary match in Group B. Both sides were already through to the quarterfinals, but they were fighting for the better position in the group. Hungary moved second with the win. Hungary have won 3 Olympic gold medals in succession, but they haven't been at their best in these games. They were in great form here, though. While Hungary's goal scoring was clean and clinical, the USA's were mainly scrappy. Hungary were the leading goal scorers through the preliminary rounds. This was their 60th of the games. The United States rallied in the final quarter, but they were outplayed overall. The defending champions looked to be coming into form at just the right time.
In the final of the men's trap shooting, Michael Diamond started with a slim lead over Fahaid Al-Dahani. Diamond had set an Olympic record with a maximum score of 125 in qualifying. The scores were so close, any of the 6 finalists could win. Diamond missed 5 targets during the final. This was the second in a row. That allowed Giovanni Cernogoras to move into joint first place, along with Massimo Fabrizi. After 25 shots each, there were ties for first place and third. There would have to be 2 shoot-offs, one for the gold medal, the other for bronze. The bronze medal shoot-off took place first between Diamond and Al-Dahani. Diamond had to shoot second in each round, so effectively each shot was an attempt to stay in the competition. In round 4, this miss by Diamond handed third place to Al-Dahani. Then came the gold medal shoot-off between Fabrizi and Cernogoras. Fabrizi had first shot in each round. They both hit the first 5 targets, but this miss by Fabrizi gave Cernogoras a shot at the gold medal. After firing 155 shots over the course of qualifying, the final and the shoot-off, and with only 4 missed, Cernogoras had this chance to win the title. Delight for Cernogoras, who started the final in joint 5th place, 3 shots behind the top qualifier. The bronze went to Al-Dahani, who also finished 3rd in the double trap event in Sydney in 2000. The silver for Massimo Fabrizi, who only missed out in the gold medal shoot-off. And gold for Cernogoras, who only missed 1 target out of 31 during the final and the shoot-off.
I am very, very happy. I work a lot for these Olympic Games, and now I win the gold. It's fantastic. It's the first medal on Olympic Games for me. It's emotion. It's fantastic.
Synchronized swimming from the Aquatic Center. The second part of qualification for the finals in duets is the free routine preliminary. There were 24 teams looking to qualify for the 12-team final. The Russians, Ashenko and Romashina, led after the technical routine. In the free routine, the score is comprised of 2 elements. The technical merit score, which is broken into execution, synchronization and difficulty, and the impression, where the judges focus on choreography, music interpretation, and manner of presentation. The Russians excelled at all areas with a brilliant routine. The two combined to pose the highest score of all participants. Spain's Carbonell and Fuentes entered the free routine in third place. They showed great creativity in their routine. They used an egg beater kick to create great height and showcase synchronized arm movements. The two will enter the finals in contention for a medal. China's Huang and Liu showed great deck work before starting their 3-minute and 30-second routine. The Chinese pair competing in their first Olympics were precise during the routine and secured the second best score. Headed into the finals, the Russians are the favorites. Their country has won every synchronized swimming duets Olympic gold medal since 2000.
South Korea and Belgium played their final group match, knowing neither team could qualify for the semi-finals. They were playing to avoid finishing bottom of the Pool A table. South Korea took the lead with less than 10 minutes played. Kim Jong-un scored the goal. It was her first of the competition. Towards the end of the first half, South Korea made it 2-0 from this penalty corner. Captain Lee Seun-ok scored the goal. It was also her first of the tournament. In the second half, Belgium fought back. Erika Coppi made it 2-1. That was only the second goal Belgium had scored in 5 quarter matches. And South Korea wrapped up victory when Kim scored her second of the match with less than 20 seconds to play. Belgium had sacrificed their goalkeeper to push forward in search of an equaliser. Belgium would finish bottom of the table, South Korea moved up to fourth, and they'll play for 7th place in the classification matches. The result, South Korea 3, Belgium 1.
Two powerhouses met at Excel North Arena 1 for men's team table tennis semifinal action, China versus Germany. In the first singles match, China's Ma Long went head-to-head with Dmitry Ovcharov. Although Ovcharov made some impressive shots, Long was equal to the task thanks to his relentless forehand. China took a 1-0 lead in match play. Match number two, also singles, saw Zhang Jika face Timo Boll. A big moment for Boll as he pulled off a 3-1 upset to the delight of the German contingent in the audience. That made it 1-1 in team match play. In doubles, Jike and Wang Hao looked for redemption against Boll and Bastian Sturger, and they got it in 4 games. To the fourth match, where China carried their momentum from doubles when Long defeated Sturger in straight games. That gave China a 3-1 overall victory, and they advanced to the team final to defend their gold.
Aside from the latest medal races, there were plenty more key developments on day 9 at the Weymouth and Portland National Sailing Center. Heading into race 15 of the men's 49er class, world champions Nathan Utteridge and Ian Jensen of Australia comfortably led the overall standings. And New Zealanders Peter Burling and Blair Tuke also enjoyed a sizable advantage over the rest of the field in second. As the start of the race approached, both crews knew that another strong finish would effectively guarantee them one of the top 2 places on the podium before the competition-ending medal race. Both the Australians and New Zealanders got off to strong enough starts, but it was the Italian boat of Giuseppe Angelilla and Gianfranco Sibello that set the early pace. While Utteridge and Jensen and Burling and Tuke tracked each other's every move. The Italians eventually sped their way home to victory by an impressive 18-second margin, ahead of the Finnish pairing of Lauri Lehtinen and Kalle Bask in second. But all of the decisive drama happened a little further back. Such had been their dominance, Australia's third place finish had mathematically guaranteed them the gold medal with a race to spare, while a 6th place finish for New Zealand meant they'd effectively also wrapped up the silver medal. cueing mass celebrations for both sets of supporters on the Dorset coast. The battle for the bronze medal, though, will go right down to the wire, with as many as six countries still in realistic contention.
The last day of group matches in the men's handball at the Copper Box brought together the strongest and the weakest teams in Group A. Iceland, the Olympic silver medalists, had won all their matches and were guaranteed a place in the quarter-final. Great Britain were desperate to leave the games with a first win in front of their home fans. Against the mighty Iceland, it would be a huge challenge. But the British team went for it right from the first whistle, led by Stephen Larsson, who scored three times within the first 10 minutes. Iceland, though, with all their ability and experience, were calling the shots. Only some inspired goalkeeping by the Great Britain captain Bobby White kept his team within 3 points at half-time. In the second half, Iceland's class came through and the goals started to fly in. From close range and long. The hosts were overwhelmed and the full-time score reflected that. Iceland move to the quarter-finals with a perfect 5 wins from 5. Great Britain lose 5 from 5, but leave the Olympics a better team and with a newfound fan base. Full-time at the Copper Box, Iceland 41, Great Britain 24.
The final game of Group A and a last chance for Argentina to qualify for the quarter-finals. A win against Great Britain would see them progress at the expense of Australia. Despite superb support from the home crowd, Britain have had a poor tournament, losing every game and not even taking a set. And Argentina would also prove far too strong. Racing into an early lead, it would help them seal the first set by 7 points. The second was similarly straightforward, and the South Americans had 1 foot in the last eight. They wrapped up the third 25-15 to confirm their quarter-final place and end Australia's Olympic Games. Great Britain's volleyball adventure also over, but not before they thanked their excellent home support.
The Velodrome played host to the women's sprint quarter-finals. Defending champion Victoria Pendleton was the first rider to book her place into the semi-finals. The 31-year-old rider from Great Britain comfortably defeated Olga Panarina of Belarus. Pendleton's main rival, Anna Mears of Australia, also comfortably progressed as she proved too strong for Lyubov Shalika of the Ukraine. Guo Shuang of China entered her quarterfinal clash with Cuba's Lissandra Rodriguez as the strong favourite. But it was the Cuban who provided an early shock, and she claimed the first spoils. In the second, the Chinese sprint specialist stormed back to claim the victory. Rodriguez complained that Shuang had impeded on her line to the finish, but a protest was turned down, and to a deciding race it would go, where Shuang proved too strong for the Cuban rider, and she will now face Anna Mears in the semi-final. Finally, German rider Christina Vogel booked her place in the semi-finals with two close victories over Simona Krupa-Koita of Lithuania. So the four riders through are Victoria Pendleton, Anna Mears, Guo Shuang, and Christina Vogel.
Basketball Arena Group B, Great Britain and China, the final match for both teams. Great Britain won comprehensively. It was their first win at the London Games. China started the match well. They scored the first 7 points of the game. Wang Shipong scored on this shot worth 3 points. But Great Britain started to take control of the match. Drew Sullivan attacked the basket with no resistance. Great Britain led by 12 points after one quarter. Second quarter, Great Britain proved to be faster and better organized. Nate Ranking with this shot from distance, worth 3 points. Great Britain led by 15 points at halftime. China had no answer for Great Britain. Joel Freeland slipped past his defender to score here. And with the result not in doubt, Great Britain played with style. Luol Deng found Eric Boateng for this basket. Later, Boateng dunked home this pass from Drew Sullivan. Great Britain closed out its Olympic Games with a convincing win over China.